the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as he stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned, bowing to the Father's will, he took a crown of thorns. Heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and redeem and reconcile the very ones who nailed him to that tree. It is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, it is free indeed. Now my debt is paid. It is paid in full by the precious blood spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, the rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah.
Praise and honor unto thee.
I'd like to ask you to join us in singing a hymn, The Old Rugged Cross.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world
trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday. So despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a cross. I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. I will cling to the exchange it someday for a crown.
by grace draw near, bless your name. You know, people often wonder why God allows bad things to happen in this world. And that always makes me wonder, what would they have God do? I mean, what do they want? How would they like to see God stop bad things? If they want God to intervene, what does that look like? Would God stop people from doing evil? Would that include you? Would you like that? Or would you resent that? That God is forcing you into a certain type of behavior. And also, who gets to define evil? You? Me? I don't think that'll work for any of us. And so I think the question of how God could stop evil is actually an impossible question to answer on a human level. God has to answer it. It has to be God's plan to eliminate evil. And yet evil continues. You know, I was watching a documentary some time back of some cops in Ohio. There was a corrupt police department in a small town, and it came to the ears of the FBI, and so they began a sting. They came into town. They set up a bar, and they had gambling in the back room. They had all kinds of stuff going on. And sure enough, it wasn't long before some of the cops came into town and started saying, you know, you need to make us a payment every month to make sure your bar stays in operation safely and soundly. And so sure enough, they had a bunch of cops on the take pretty quick, and they let this go on for a while. And the thing that I thought was kind of fascinating about it was while this sting operation was underway, there was gambling in the back room, there was prostitution happening, there was drug deals happening, there was all kinds of illegal things going on. And they let them, because for their purpose, there was something bigger that they were working on. They were trying to get rid of the bad cops. And so eventually they brought the operation to a close and arrested a bunch of cops and everything. But I thought it was interesting that crime was allowed to continue while the case rolled towards a conclusion. And I think there's an element of that in how God is dealing with evil in this world and how his plan is moving forward. Because as his plan rolls forward, evil in many different forms continues, and we have to deal with it. And it produces fear and anger and things like that. And the fear, I just hate it. I hate the fear. And yet I suffer from it. And I hate it in me. I hate it when I see it in other people, because fear makes us act in irrational manners. As a matter of fact, a lot of types of fear are irrational in themselves, and people are afraid of many things. A lot of people are afraid of snakes, even though, you know, snakes generally aren't going to hurt you. Or people are afraid of spiders, and other than black widows, spiders aren't going to hurt you. And some people are afraid of heights. I am not fond of heights. I don't like being far off the ground. And yet, it's not dangerous unless you fall, and would I really fall? But yet I'm still afraid of it. And fear can paralyze. And these days, people are afraid. And we're social distancing. And what's happening is people are becoming really kind of, you know, a lot of people hate judgmentalism. But boy, it starts coming out now, because social distancing can turn into social shaming. And if you aren't doing what people want you to do, they'll judge you in a heartbeat. Go out without a mask and people are going to start reporting you. As a matter of fact, you know, you can't get too close to someone because they may take action. This past week, there was an 86-year-old woman who died Saturday at a Brooklyn hospital. After she went to the hospital and another patient shoved her to the ground because she was too close during this pandemic. And the woman who died, who was not named, fell backwards when the other woman shoved her, and she hit her head and she died 3 hours later. And the patient who pushed the victim was given a summons for disorderly conduct. And the patient, who also was not named, told police that the elderly woman was not using proper social distancing when she asked why she pushed her. And she just answered, well, she was too close. And I tell you, I look at the numbers on this virus pandemic, and it brings up questions in my mind, and there's all kinds of theories out there. Some people have said, well, this is a bioweapon that has escaped the lab, you know, but if it is, it's like the worst bioweapon ever, with a death rate of something like 2%. Not a very effective one. And so all in all, I'm just not that afraid of the virus. What scares me is the way people are reacting, the panic. You know, crisis brings out the best in some people, but it also brings out the worst. You know, when people are hoarding, when people are going to the store and filling up shopping carts with anything they can put in there, that is essentially a form of selfishness. It's a way to say, I want mine and I don't care about you. Selfishness and fear and panic bring out the worst in us. And we begin to see how broken we are. It just becomes obvious when fear enters the picture. We live in a broken world. And not just the way society acts, but the fact that there's even a virus is a concern. It's a broken world, but God has a plan, and God is fixing it. And Good Friday, the death of Christ, is a major part of it. See, God is on the job, but his desire is higher than just making you and me happy at this moment. God knows that our happiness ultimately depends on our holiness. You can't really have one without the other. Holiness, in this sense, actually means to be separate from the chaos, to not be part of the chaos, to think differently and to understand at a deeper level. And it's not a religion thing. It's just reality. It's just the way the world is. God's plan is playing out on the stage of world history, where it can be seen by anyone who pays attention. You know, God created the world. He created us. But we thought we knew better than God, as we still do, and so we ignored what he said about how we should live, as we still do today. And ultimately, it's human arrogance and human defiance and human rebellion that destroyed our relationship with God, and the world fell into a slow decay. And it's going on even now. The Bible tells us that even nature was corrupted by our rebellion. And so we die. Everything dies. We live in a world where we can be killed by something so tiny we can't even see it. And then even those things that can kill us, they die. Everything dies. This is a world of death. And so God put his plan into action. And we can track it through history. He developed a race of people, the nation of Israel. He took a family and placed them in Egypt and used it as almost like an incubator to develop this entire nation. And then he spent centuries teaching them who he is, what he cares about. And he used this race of people to write down his plan, to record the history of how all this happened. And for hundreds of years, he told the nation of Israel about one who would be born among them. He told them where. He told them how. He gave a line of descent. He described what this chosen one would do. This chosen one would in effect push the reset button that begins the repair process of humanity. And we're in that process now. You know, we reboot our computers and our phones to clear out the errors and to clear out the malfunction and to start over. And it's the same thing with humanity. God needs to clear out the errors. In the case of humanity, it's the defiance, it's the rebellion, it's the arrogance, it's the hubris, it's the selfishness that we're seeing around us these days. You know, we live in a corrupted world, and we all know it. God's working to fix it, but his repair plan is based on changing people. To clear out the errors on a case-by-case basis and changing everyone who will come to him for treatment. God is creating a people who choose to love instead of choosing selfishness, who choose to believe God enough to obey him, and through that obedience to become renewed, to become what and to become who we were created to be. And to those, he gives the promise of becoming like Jesus, the suffering servant, as we saw in the scripture that started our service tonight. So trusting in God, his Father, that he willingly submitted to death, a horrible death. And it's through that death that his life becomes available to us. You know, we all know, even if we try to put it out of our minds, we all know that we are going to die. You know, could be the virus, could be some other disease, could be an accident, but there's no escaping it. But I think in this time that people are considering things in a different way, and it really kind of struck me that this virus could be a life-changing event for you. If it refocuses how you look at the world, if it reshapes what you think is important, and if it causes you to think about God's role in your life. You know, God has a plan to change this world. And it starts with changing you. And it starts with changing me. If we desire it. If we allow it. Jesus accomplished the central part of the plan on the cross. And that's why, just before he died, Jesus shouted, "It is finished." Years later, one of Jesus' closest friends, a man named John, wrote the book of Revelation. And as we go through the book of Revelation, near the end, John writes this. John is seeing a vision of heaven. And near the end, he says, "I heard a loud shout from the throne, saying, 'Look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or sorrow, or crying, or pain. All these things are gone forever.'" This is the completion of the plan. This is where it's headed. But it's a process that is playing out in front of us right now, in this world and in our lives. John continues, and the one sitting on the throne said, "Look, I am making everything new." That is an incredible promise. All this corruption, all this chaos in this world will be eliminated. I am making everything new. It's a reset. It's fixing the corruption in the system. And then a voice said to John, "Write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy and true." And then this is amazing, because as a reminder, Jesus is speaking in this passage. As a reminder, he also said, "It is finished." He echoes what was said on the cross at the end of that process, the redemption, the restoration, the process of that beginning was finished on the cross. And then here at the end of the whole story, Jesus said, "It is finished," because the whole plan had come to a completion. And everything was repaired. He said, "I am the Alpha and the Omega." Those are the Greek letters that begin and end of Greek alphabet. They mean, "I am the beginning and the end. And to all who are thirsty, I will give freely from the springs of the water of life. All who are victorious will inherit all these blessings, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." All who are victorious will inherit all these blessings. I will be their God, and they will be my children. It's an amazing promise. The fact is, if you're a believer, you are a part of God's plan to clear out the evil, the errors, the corruption that fills humanity, fills this world. And God promises that you will live forever in the presence of God. That's what was accomplished on the cross, as Jesus was obedient, trusting God completely, even to the point of death. But if you're not a believer, if you choose to live in defiance of God, in rebellion against Him, then you won't live forever in His perfect love and joy. I mean, that just makes sense. You will exist in separation from the only source of love and joy and peace. A life without love, a life without joy, a life without peace. That's called hell. You know, God has given us many ways to remember this reality in which we live, this not religion, but reality, which is God's plan becoming known through the pages of history, playing out in full view of anyone who chooses to pay attention. And the central part of that plan was the death of Christ, which we celebrate, which we remember tonight. And Jesus explained it. He made it clear to His closest friends as they shared a meal on the night He was betrayed and arrested. And He gave us something to remember His death. And Steve Rowe will now lead us in the Lord's Supper.
We come to communion now, and I'm going to be looking at the text from 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 28, and I'll be reading out of the New Living Bible. As I was looking at this passage, it became apparent to me that Paul makes mention that we need to be worthy of doing this. But he puts it in a contrary way. He says that we need to be careful not to do it in an unworthy manner, taking the cup and the bread. And he says that is why you should examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup. And as I began reflecting on my own life, I thought, what would make me do this in an unworthy manner? It seems to me that if I think I'm worthy, that somehow this is just a religious ritual tacked on to the fact that I'm a good person, I believe, I'm confident in my own righteousness. That would be an unworthy manner that I'm doing that. It would almost seem that to be worthy, we have to realize our unworthiness. To do it in an unworthy manner would be to think that somehow we are worthy of this, that we merit Christ's forgiveness, that there's something I've done in and of myself to deserve his forgiveness, his grace. And it's really not that. And I realized that, you know, it's interesting that baptism wasn't something that Jesus asked us to repeat. We've done it once. But taking the Lord's Supper or communion, he says, as often as you do this. And that seems very appropriate to me because, at least in my own life, I always am having to be reminded that, Steve, it's not your own righteousness. It's not your own ability to obey and follow it perfectly, the will of God. That's not where it's at. And so I think every time we come to the communion table, we're reminded that this is all of grace. And the Bible says, Paul wrote, we're saved by grace through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, lest any man boast. I don't think it would be appropriate either to take this and believe that it was some magical formula that protects me. That somehow it's like getting a vaccination. It's not that. They are symbols holy of something holy that Jesus did and that he accomplished for us on the cross. There are many covenants that have been identified in the Bible, but Jesus calls this a new covenant in his blood. I'll read both passages, one focusing on the bread, the other on the cup, and at the end, I'll pray. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 11:23, for I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread, and he gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's do that together now. Continuing on in verse 25, in the same way he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes. Let's take the cup. Thank you so much, Lord Jesus, that you offered your body and shed your blood on the cross for us in atonement for sin. We don't work off our sins, Father. You have provided forgiveness of sins through the death of Christ on the cross for us. And we thank you for that, for accomplishing all that perfectly and forever for us. We trust you, and we announce your death as being the sacrifice, totally sufficient, totally effective in cleansing us of all our sin. Thank you. Thank you that we can know now that there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And we pray in his name. Thank you. Amen. Mm-hmm.
so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. See you for Easter. Thanks for coming.